Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Major General Mike Myatt and the Marines Memorial Association, and our co-sponsors for this event, the World Affairs Council, welcome to our program tonight. We have with us tonight the author of a new book, The ISIS Apocalypse, The History, Strategy, and Doomsday Vision of the Islamic State. My name is Chris Starling, and I'm the Director of Military and Veteran Affairs here at the Marines Memorial Association, and I'll be your moderator for this evening. The Marines Memorial Association is a nonprofit veterans organization that's chartered to honor the legacy of military service. And to learn more about the organization, you can see our website, www.marineclub.com. The World Affairs Council offers a neutral forum on critical international issues and opportunities. And to learn more about the council, please visit their website at worldaffairs.org. We are going to record tonight's event for radio, and I would like to, in advance, thank our audio engineer, Jim Bennett. And I would like to now introduce our author, Dr. Will McCants. William McCants is a fellow at the Brookings Institution Center for Middle East Policy in Washington, D.C. He's also a member of the adjunct faculty at Johns Hopkins University, and he's held numerous government and think tank positions related to Islam, the Middle East, and terrorism. From 2009 to 2011, Will McCants served as a U.S. State Department senior advisor for countering violent extremism. He's been an analyst with the Department of Defense, with the Center for Naval Analysis, and was also a fellow at West Point's Combating Terrorism Center, which is our preeminent center for that kind of work in the country. His new book, The ISIS Apocalypse, was published this year. Dr. McCants is proficient in Islamic theology as well as history and is fluent in the Arabic language. Most of the source material for this book came from documents written in Arabic and include personal correspondence between senior leaders of Al-Qaeda and what we know as ISIS. Dr. McCants has a PhD from Princeton University. He's lived in Israel, in Egypt, and in Lebanon. He's been featured in Foreign Policy Magazine, the New York Times, and in many television shows as of late. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Will McCants.
I hope it doesn't end up being too dreary, but the weather sort of matches the dark mood of the subject. Tonight, I guess I want to try and answer a basic question that I get asked a lot and was really the motivation for writing the book, which is, why has ISIS been so successful? Today, its government in Syria and Iraq controls a territory that stretches from Mosul to Aleppo. That's about the drive from Washington, D.C. to Cleveland, Ohio, which I know very well because I go there every Christmas for my wife and kids. They rule over a population that numbers between 2.5 and 5.5 million people. They have a war chest that some estimate at $2 billion, and they take in millions a day from tax revenue and oil and the selling of antiquities. It is a powerful insurgent organization at the very least, and a weak state at best. How did they do this? And for someone like me who has studied the Islamic State since its founding in 2006, it's a baffling question, because the organization was so soundly defeated in 2009. So how did it make this comeback? How did it take so much territory? So I want to offer an explanation to you tonight. And I want to argue that the reasons for its failure in 2009 are the same reasons for its success in 2014. The Islamic State has a three-part formula. And the three parts are this. I'll list them, and then I'll walk through each of them. And I'll explain initially how they contributed to the organization's failure, and then how it contributed to its success today. So here are the three parts. The first part is reestablishing the early Islamic empire known as the Caliphate, establishing it now rather than later. I'll come back and explain. The second part of the formula is abiding by the dictum of it is better to be feared than loved. You would rather terrify people than try to win over their hearts and minds. The third part of the formula is an emphasis on end of days and the belief that God is bringing the world to a swift judgment and that the Islamic State is in the vanguard of those true few Muslims who are fighting the infidel before the world ends. So apocalypse now rather than later. So those are the three elements. Caliphate now rather than later. Brutality rather than hearts and minds. Apocalypse now rather than later. So here's what all of that means. Caliphate now. The caliphate was the name for the early Islamic empire. And there was a single ruler at the top, a fellow who had the office of caliph. And it means deputy, considered the deputy of God or the deputy of the founder of Islam, Muhammad. It's someone who wielded supreme spiritual and political authority. Over time, this office lost its power. It lost its spiritual authority. It lost its political authority. But in the Sunni Muslim world, and you know that Islam is divided into two parts, Sunni and Shia, and the Sunni is the biggest one. 9 out of 10 Muslims you'll ever meet are Sunni. In the Sunni world, the office was still important. And various rulers would claim it throughout the Middle Ages. And the last great empire to claim to be a caliphate was the Ottoman Empire, which was ruled from what is today Turkey, but covered much of the Middle East. The Ottoman Empire backed the wrong side in World War I, and as a consequence, the Allies dismembered the empire. And one of the new nations that arose in its place was the modern state of Turkey, and the founder of Turkey, Ataturk, wasn't a big fan of religion, and he did away with this office of caliph in the 1920s, abolished it. For many conservative Sunni Muslims, this was an outrage because they wanted this office to still continue to abide. They didn't feel you could really have a Muslim community without this person at the top. And so they convened a number of conferences to try and revive this institution, but they couldn't agree on who would hold the office. And this was really the beginning of a movement that scholars call political Islam or Islamism, but it was the desire to restore Islam back to the center of public life. Most of the people who are part of this movement were nonviolent, but there's a violent variety as well, and we call them jihadists. And the jihadists are the ones who are fighting to restore this caliphate, restore the empire. But they differ with one another over the timing of when to establish it. Groups like Al-Qaeda believe that the caliphate will come in the far future, that the Muslims are simply too weak in order to establish it. First, you have to get rid of the United States, get it out of the Middle East, then overthrow the local rulers, and then you can think about bringing back the caliphate. And this is the common wisdom for many jihadists. They saw it as a far-off thing. The founders of the Islamic State deeply disagreed with that proposition. They argued that the Muslims were ready to establish it today, and that they were strong enough to build it and to fend off anyone who would seek to overthrow it. Caliphate now rather than later. Build it and go from strength to strength, reconquering Muslim majority countries and then eventually the entire world. They attempted to do this in 2006. They dissolved Al-Qaeda in Iraq, the leader of it did, and they established an organization they called the Islamic State. The problem is the Islamic State didn't really control any territory, and for other jihadists, they saw it as laughable, because one of the main prerequisites of having a state is you actually have some land. So they were much laughed at, but nevertheless, they insisted that they were a state, and they demanded that all of the other rebel groups that were fighting in Iraq against the Americans, against the government in Baghdad, they demanded that they bend the knee and consider it a state. And the other rebel groups said, no, we won't. And so it created a lot of friction then between the Islamic State, so-called, and these other rebel groups. And it is one of the things that led several of these rebel groups to begin working with the Americans to get rid of the Islamic State. And it's what we call the Sunni Arab Awakening. A number of these tribes that had been fighting against the United States all of a sudden began to flip. So this backfired on the Islamic State. Didn't work out for it too well. All right, so that's element one of the formula, not going so great. Element number two of the formula is the brutality. The common wisdom in Al-Qaeda's leadership was that if their political project was ever going to be successful, if they were ever going to succeed in establishing Islamic states in the Middle East, because they didn't consider any of the current ones legitimate, if they were ever going to succeed through force of arms, they had to have the support of the majority of the population. Otherwise, their project would have no lasting significance, that the population simply wouldn't abide by a government that they didn't want to be in there. And so the Islamic State, Al-Qaeda, emphasized winning over hearts and minds, and they use this phrase in their literature, winning over hearts and minds of Muslims. Now, the infidel, it doesn't matter. You can do what you want to the infidel, but among Muslims, Al-Qaeda believed you had to win over a majority of the population. And that is generally the advice that they would offer their foot soldiers. And some of them would abide by it, some of them would not, but at least that's the strategic direction that they took. They even went so far as advising their affiliates not to quickly implement Islamic law, which was very important for these jihadists, implementing Islamic law. They said, don't do it so fast, because many of the requirements of Islamic law are pretty harsh. The people are not going to be ready for it. Go slowly. Again, it has to do with their hearts and minds approach. The Islamic State deeply disagreed with this thesis as well. They argued that it was more efficient and more effective to be brutal to people. And they were not trying to win over the masses. Rather, they argued that you needed to polarize the Muslim masses and cause them to make a choice, a black and white choice between being with us or being with everyone else. And this is the policy that they pursued. They took on enemies on all sides. They were brutal to the people they proposed to govern. And as a consequence, those people didn't like it very much. And this, again, is another reason why there was growing dissatisfaction with the Islamic State in the previous decade in Iraq, and one of the reasons that fed into this Sunni tribal awakening or revolt against the Islamic State to get rid of it. So, element number two, then, of the Islamic State's formula not working so well. And in fact, Al-Qaeda's leaders, bin Laden, Zawahiri, held the Islamic State up as an example of what not to do. And they were constantly writing letters to its leadership saying you have to build a broad base of support before you can ever think about establishing a state. And for God's sake, stop it with the beheading videos. They said, sure, if you want to execute a prisoner, do it. But for God's sake, please do it off camera. Don't do it on camera, because it's not just horrifying the world, who cares, but it's horrifying normal Sunni Muslims, and we can't have that. It's bad for our brand, and it's bad for our political project. We need them on side. Nevertheless, the Islamic State persisted and suffered the consequences. So, caliphate now, not working well. Brutality, not working very well. How about the apocalyptic stuff? It is unusual for a Sunni militant group like the Islamic State to be interested in the apocalypse, and it's very interested in the apocalypse and the end of days. Most modern Sunni groups really play down these prophecies. They don't tend to emphasize it, either in their recruitment or in their explanation of events. The Islamic State is unusual. It quotes many of the Islamic prophecies about the end times in its propaganda and as a way to draw recruits. And for those who are unfamiliar with that literature, just a brief summary. In early Islam, there were a series of civil wars as people fought over who was going to run the community, who was going to be the caliph after Muhammad died. And each side in these civil wars would invent prophecies foretelling their inevitable victory and the other side's inevitable defeat. And in order to give these prophecies some currency, they would attribute them to Muhammad. And these things proliferated. There's thousands of them. They're not in the Quran. They're in other kinds of scripture. And they number in, you know, tens, hundreds of volumes. The political circumstances that generated these prophecies, the civil wars that brought them about, were all happening in Syria and Iraq. So all the prophecies mention places in Syria and Iraq. The apocalypse is going to happen in a tiny village outside of Aleppo. Jesus is going to descend from the heavens and fight on the side of the Muslims, and he's going to come down in Damascus, and so on and so forth. The political events that created these prophecies evaporated, but the prophetic residue remained, and later generations would reinterpret it based on contemporary political events, much as Christians throughout the centuries have reinterpreted the book of Revelations, much of which had to do with the Roman Empire, but continued to be reinterpreted over history. Muslims do the same thing with this literature. So whenever there is a political or a social cataclysm in the part of the world where the prophecies are supposed to be fulfilled, it invites this interpretation, this framework. So when you have, say, an invasion of Iraq in 2003, or you have a civil war in Syria beginning in 2012, 2013, all of a sudden these prophecies gain much more currency. And for many Sunnis, that began to happen after the US invasion in 2003. They were largely uninterested in these prophecies until that happened. And all of a sudden, books that had been commercial duds about the end times became bestsellers. And it was America who was put front and center in the end times drama. So it became a very, very inviting target for groups that wanted to recruit on this basis. The Islamic State is the only one that did. Other Sunni groups generally, like, we don't want to talk about this stuff. The Islamic State really emphasized it. Not only emphasized it for recruitment in 2006, 2007, but also actually believed it. This wasn't cynical. We know this because there was a secret letter sent from one of their chief judges to al-Qaeda's leadership complaining about the founder of the Islamic State and said, this guy is an apocalyptic nut. He believes that the end of the world is going to come at any moment, and that we have to prepare for the end times, and that a Muslim savior figure is going to come and win out over the infidel, and we're going to conquer the whole world in a matter of months. And he was making military decisions on this basis. For example, he ordered his commanders to fan out over Iraq because he said within a matter of weeks, the prophecies say they're going to conquer it. Of course, it didn't happen, and they came back home with their tail between their legs. But he was making decisions on this basis, so much so that al-Qaeda's leadership wrote him and said, knock it off. This is a terrible way to make military decisions on the battlefield. It's causing you to be too hasty. Please stop speculating about the end of the world. But nevertheless, it was something that consumed the early Islamic State, and it saw itself in many ways as a fulfillment of prophecy. So that wasn't working for it. the third element of its formula, was causing it to make bad military decisions. So all of this together then amounts for a recipe for failure. It didn't work. The Islamic State did not really change any element of this formula in the ensuing years. It's continued this same basic approach, and yet it has been wildly successful. Why? The reason why has to do with a change in the political circumstances. You will remember in the preceding decade, there was the world's mightiest military on the ground to counter the Islamic State. It wasn't simply a tribal awakening that threw off the Islamic State. It was a concerted effort by the US military to push it back underground. Never destroyed it, but pushed it back underground as a clandestine terror organization. But there was a troop drawdown. US forces began leaving Iraq. So all of a sudden, the Islamic State began to have more room to breathe. At the same time, there was a civil war that broke out in Syria, giving them territory to operate in. And they took advantage of it better than the other groups. Why? There were many different groups that could have taken advantage of the same circumstances and done what the Islamic State did. Why was the Islamic State successful? I would say it's the same three things that caused its defeat before. First of all, caliphate now, state building. It was the only group that focused on state building in the Sunni hinterland between Syria and Iraq, while all the other rebel groups were busy trying to overthrow an existing state. So the Islamic State then was building up its own institutions, taking territory because it thought of itself as a state, and it was building in a part of Syria in the first instance, later Iraq, in parts of Syria and Iraq that did not interest over much the central governments. And if you're Bashar al-Assad, the ruler of Syria, and you're trying to prioritize which of the rebel groups you're going to focus on, who are coming after you, you're going to focus on the people that are pushing towards Damascus and the Eastern Mediterranean, the parts of the country you care about that are essential for your rule. You're not going to worry about the guys off in the countryside who are building this state. You'll come around to them eventually. So by focusing on state building in a part of the country that the regime did not prioritize, the Islamic State had an opportunity to realize its aim, the brutality stuff versus hearts and minds. Why did that end up working for it, where it had been a disaster just a few years previous? It worked because there was no major military there, again, to counter it. And it turns out, if you are brutal to people and you scare the hell out of them, you can be quite efficient in state building and running a government. We forget that many governments were founded this way and sustain themselves this way. And the Islamic State rules through fear. They have other levers they pull, of course. They reward their allies, they give them a share of the spoils, so on and so forth, but fear is the order of the day because they found it so efficient, in contrast to the other rebel groups that tried to work more in coalitions. So Al-Qaeda, for example, in Syria, which is also known as the Nusra Front, it wanted to work with the other rebel groups, which was fine in the sense of embedding it in the insurgency, but it meant that they were pretty inefficient at running in any territory they captured. Why? Because they could never come to a consensus among these rebel groups about who was calling the shots. So it was very inefficient then in trying to administer territory, whereas the Islamic State guys just went about eliminating anybody who threatened their rule, pushing out the other rebel groups, and ruling through fear. Just more efficient when there was no one there to counter them. So it's working in their favor. Now, how about the apocalyptic stuff? This is one area where the Islamic State made one slight tweak, and that tweak was it moved away from this kind of messianic sort of apocalypticism, and it became focused on state building as a fulfillment of prophecy, the return of the caliphate as a fulfillment of prophecy. Rather than worrying about some savior figure who could pop up at any moment and send things into disarray, it was now focused on a stable, enduring political project of building institutions and a state, and it sold itself as a fulfillment of prophecy. It was the only rebel group to sell itself as a fulfillment of prophecy. None of the other rebel groups did. And as a consequence, they had an edge in recruiting foreigners. Now, the apocalyptic stuff did not matter so much to the locals. I mean, they lived there. But for the foreigners, it ended up proving to be decisive for many of them as to why they traveled and joined. And think about it. Think about what it takes to leave your family, your friends, your job, travel to a foreign country. Probably you don't speak the language. If you believe the end of the world is imminent, and you believe that you can have a role to play in it, it can be a big motivator. And for many young people who are going there, that's a big part of it. They want to participate in building this state, which is a fulfillment of prophecy and getting ready for the end times. There was a Wall Street Journal reporter who interviewed one Islamic State recruiter in Lebanon, and the recruiter said the apocalyptic recruiting pitch works every time. So they had an edge in bringing in the foreign fighters. They have attracted tens of thousands of them. Why is that important? Because foreigners are much better shock troops than the locals. The locals have family ties. They have tribal ties. They know these people. They're going to have a tough time being brutal in these areas. The foreigners have none of those ties, and therefore they make much better cadres for administering and controlling these newly conquered territories. So that's the package then. That's the formula that had been such a failure in the preceding decade was now a great success because the political circumstances had changed. You had widespread Sunni anger and dissatisfaction with their central governments, and you had those governments otherwise distracted or focused elsewhere and no major military presence on the ground to counter the rise of this organization. And that's why, sticking to their principles, they have become such a wild success today. Thank you.
I want to start off with one. You have studied Islam, you have studied it from the outside in and then focused in on what's going on now. And I have my own opinion of this, is Islam an inherently violent religion? Is it something that other religions can reconcile with and live in a harmonious world?
Thank you. It's a question that comes up a lot, including from my own father. So I have had a lot of experience in talking about it. The truth of the matter is that if you look in Islamic scripture, you will find many passages that endorse violence in the service of a religious cause. And that's just a fact. The question is what to make of this literature. What you should know about Islamic scripture is it is vast. You think it's just the Quran. It is not just the Quran. It is a body of literature that records the words and deeds attributed to Muhammad. He may have said it, he may not have. It's the kind of literature that's very similar to the Gospels, right? So Christian scholars will debate whether did Jesus really say this or not. Same thing for Muhammad, but it numbers in the hundreds of volumes. And most of the really violent stuff is in that literature. But there is also many passages in there that portray Muhammad in a very peaceful light and emphasizing harmonious living with other religious communities. And so the big challenge then for scholars in the Middle Ages was to try and reconcile all of this literature. And it's really an impossible task because there were so many contradictions. So Muslims then have to today make sense of the same contradictions. Some of them, like the Islamic State, are able to find the violent passages in Scripture that justify what they want to do. More progressive Muslims will find passages that validate tolerance and peaceful coexistence with other religions. And the question that often comes up is the Islamic State Islamic? And my answer is always, you have to ask a Muslim. I mean, it's really for them to decide. I can tell you that the things that it points to in Scripture to justify what it does exist. But I can also tell you that the people who argue against them are able to produce their own Scripture as well. There's one other point I want to make on this, and it's that sometimes the Islamic State's reading of Scripture is selective, as you might imagine. And I noticed this when I was comparing its use of Scripture and Al-Qaeda's use of Scripture. Both of these are what I would consider to be ultra-conservatives, and they practice the kind of Islam that you would find in Saudi Arabia. But when they read Scripture, they find different things in there that suit their biases. Al-Qaeda wanted to wage a hearts and minds campaign. So the Scripture that it found justified the hearts and minds campaign. The Islamic State wants to wage a brutal campaign. The Scripture it finds are verses and passages that justify a brutal campaign. I also saw where the Islamic State would studiously ignore passages that went against what it wanted to do. And this is important because it tells you something about their strategy. You'll remember the burning of the Jordanian pilot. Horrific. And the Islamic State filmed it. This was a fellow Sunni Muslim. And the Islamic State said he was an apostate, and they burned him by fire. The problem that they encountered was that Islamic scripture expressly forbids the burning of apostates by fire, because only God is allowed to burn apostasy in hell, in the next world. So you're not supposed to do it. Scripture says you are not supposed to do it. Scripture also says you are not supposed to kill non-combatants. You can't kill women and children. They do that too. What do they do about this? Well, they find other scripture that they think gives them a license in order to do so. The point is that if you are looking for rough passages in Islamic scripture, if you're looking for things that can justify violence, it is there. But what I would look for first is, what is the worldview that they are bringing to the reading of scripture first? Because like anybody, they will read it for a bias. And you can tell what their bias is by what they choose to ignore.
Yeah, well, I would just comment, having been in a lot of different countries, lived in Abu Dhabi for a year, I lived up on the Syrian and Iraqi border for a year, and I've spent time in the Shia part of Iraq, and you can't paint an entire religion with one brush, and you can find, I've felt very uncomfortable in places, and yet I've felt very comfortable in other places, and so my sense is that there is an ability to have a peaceful reconciliation. I think the small minority that gets hold of the scriptures that you're talking about is getting most of the press right now, and that's the part of the problem. Second question, let's talk about ISIS strategy. They took the city of Mosul. They then took the city of Ramadi. Prior to that, ISIL took the city of Fallujah, where we spent a lot of blood and treasure and rebuilding the city of Fallujah to really be a model city. And those of us that were in those cities, that there are some emotional connections to that still. Now you see ISIS starting to branch out, franchising in other countries. You describe the flag of ISIS in your book, and it's different than the Al-Qaeda flag. And this flag pops up, and you've got franchises in North Africa, in the Maghreb, in Yemen, even in Afghanistan, popping up. Is the strategy changing, or is it just evolving? What's going on with ISIS's strategy of how they're expanding their influence?
Right. So they present themselves as a return of the caliphate, so they need to continue to acquire territory, particularly in Muslim-majority countries, in order to validate their propaganda. And so they've had a concerted effort over the past year to try and expand into other countries, and they've had some success in moving into places where there's a security vacuum, where there are weak or failing states, Libya, Yemen, for example. And they have had some moderate gains in those areas. I think the place where they have really made a change or a shift in their strategy is in global terrorism. This is an organization that for most of its history focused on the acquisition of territory in the Middle East. But we have seen over the past few months that it's beginning to hit more international targets, and particularly the organized campaign in Paris just a few weeks ago. As strange as this might sound, I think these attacks are a function of the losses it has suffered in Syria and Iraq. It has lost 25% of its territory. It's lost tens of thousands of its fighters. It put in place this foreign operations capability when the bombs started falling on it back in August from the United States and its allies, and it is ramping up its efforts because of these losses in Syria and Iraq. It wants to compensate for the purposes of recruitment, but most importantly, it wants to punish its enemies. The Islamic State does not have an air force. It has human-guided munitions, and it is using them against its enemies. And I would anticipate that the more territory that it loses in Syria and Iraq, in other words, the more successful we are at displacing its government, the more we can anticipate that there will be more terror attacks in reprisal.
Okay, so we've looked at ISIS's strategy. Let's look at our U.S. strategy. You worked in the State Department. First question, do we have a strategy? What is it? And, you know, what, as we look at a very complex situation with Iranian influence in Iraq, the Shia influence there, with the dissolution of Syria as a failed state, with Bashar al-Assad trying to hold on to power, multiple groups that you described fighting among each other and also fighting the regime, do we have a holistic strategy to this? Because it appears to me that we are piecemealing efforts in a lot of different areas without a cohesive strategy.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Look, there's three components to the Islamic State problem, and you have to address each of them, and I think we're doing better in some areas than others. One is its government in Syria and Iraq. The second component are its affiliates, or provinces, as it calls them, in the failed or failing states of the Middle East. And then the third is an international terror organization, which it is putting into place. So how are we doing on these three? I think we're doing relatively well, actually, despite recent events, in dealing with the international terrorism. The attacks that have been carried out here, the few attacks, have been by people that have no direct connection with the organization. They are hard to stop. But it was not like the San Bernardino attack was not like the Paris attack, which was far more organized. We are blessed, extremely blessed, to have an ocean between us and this conflict. But we have been working on this for 10 years. We are pretty good at playing defense. It's not always perfect. People will get through, but we're pretty good at it since 9/11. The campaign in Syria and Iraq is going modestly well, right? They still have their government there, but they have lost some territory, which is why we're seeing these attacks. There is a lot of virtue to the go-it-slow approach. We could certainly send in a large number of American forces or forces with our allies and crush this government, no question. But we've been there before, and the best we could hope to do is to push it back underground. The truth is that there is an underlying political dysfunction in Syria and Iraq, widespread Sunni disenfranchisement, and until they are wound back into the government, which actively alienated this population in Syria and Iraq, it will be difficult to push the Islamic State back down. It thrives on this discontent. I would also offer to you that even though the Islamic State represents the least threat to the American homeland, it is the Americans that take it the most serious and are doing the most to fight it. All of our other allies have other priorities. And let me quickly go around the horn. All of the countries that border the Islamic State don't see its destruction as their top priority. Turkey, our NATO ally, is more worried about the Kurds establishing a state on their border than they are about the Islamic State. In fact, they allowed a lot of Islamic State fighters to go there in hopes that they would blunt the Kurds. The Kurds themselves are more worried about setting up their own homeland than they are about taking over Sunni Arab majority areas where they wouldn't really be welcomed. The government in Baghdad, which is a Shia-dominated government, is wary of the Sunnis, is not thrilled about going into these Sunni areas, and they feel like they have done pretty well in firewalling off the Shia majority areas of the country. So they're not eager to press into this part of the country that's Sunni dominated, where they don't think they're going to be welcome and be able to hold it. Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia's top priority is Iran. It's in a cold war with Iran, and most of its firepower is directed against Iranian proxies in Assad in Syria, but also in Yemen. The Saudi government has not flown a sortie with us against the Islamic State in 3 months. Why? All of its planes are dropping bombs in Yemen. The only country that you might think shares U.S. priority of the destruction of the Islamic State is Jordan. But Jordan is a relatively weak actor and has a lot of problems at home. So I would say that in dealing with the Islamic State's government in Syria and Iraq, we're doing about the best we can do given the nature of the threat to us and also the fact that our allies are just distracted and are really free riding on our own efforts. The third part where I do think we do not have a good strategy is what to do about these affiliates. What do you do about these insurgent groups that fly the ISIS flag in Libya, in Yemen, growing in Somalia, in Egypt, in Afghanistan? What do you do about these? As we saw with the downing of the Russian airliner, they can represent a real threat to American citizens traveling abroad. We do not have a coherent, cohesive plan for dealing with those affiliates. And it's not an easy plan to come up with either, because you think the situation in Syria and Iraq is complicated? Try dealing with Libya. Try dealing with Yemen. They are as much, if not more so, complicated.
Yeah, and it clearly requires an international effort, yeah, international intelligence sharing, and a preponderance of special operations forces, which are really the type of force you need to apply against right. This kind of problem. So the next question, there were several questions from the audience about money and funding. We always say follow the money, and it'll lead you somewhere. Who is funding ISIS? Are they able to fund themselves with their conquered territories? There's always a lot of talk about Wahhabism and Salafism has its roots in Saudi Arabia. And a lot of times, some of the articles you read point back into Saudi Arabia, an allied country of ours, as the source of funding for ISIS.
Right. So there's no question that there's an ideological affinity between the Islamic State and Saudi Arabia. They both practice this ultra-conservative form of Islam. As a matter of fact, when the Islamic State needed school textbooks in some of its newly captured territories and it didn't have them, it used Saudi school textbooks that are available online. So theologically, there's not much distance. Politically, they hate one another. And the Saudis do not like the Islamic State. They just don't see its destruction as their top priority right now. They're certainly not sending money their way. There would probably be some wealthy citizens in Saudi Arabia who would be keen to do so. But a lot of their money ends up going to the other ultra-conservative fighting groups. The Islamic State made the decision early in its history not to rely overmuch on foreign funders because they believed this was a major vulnerability of Al-Qaeda because the United States had gotten so good at going after foreign funders. So they tried to raise their money locally. So even back when you were there, they were doing kidnapping for ransom, extortion, so on and so forth in order to raise cash. They've gotten even better at that today. They control a state, albeit weak, and most of their money comes from tax revenues, like any other state. And they use it to feed their engine of war. They also derive some money from oil as well, and which they're pretty agnostic about who they sell it to. They'll sell it to Turkish black marketeers. They will even sell it to the Assad regime. And they will buy weapons from the same people as well. But most of their money comes from taxes.
Thomas Friedman writes a lot of articles, and he recently wrote a piece where he said he was talking about recruiting for ISIS, and the recruits for ISIS are, a lot of them are in refugee camps. They're in impoverished villages. No education, no job, no girlfriend. ISIS offers them all three. And oversimplification and, you know, caveat to that, are we losing the virtual, the battle in the virtual battle space with this organization? They are very tech savvy, more than we would have ever expected.
That's true. I don't think they recruit much in the camps yet. I mean, we can anticipate from other conflicts that that will be something that will come, which is even more reason to try and make sure these camps are well taken care of. Most of their recruits are local Syrians and Iraqis. Some of them join just because they want a paycheck. It's a war zone and government money has been cut off. Some join because they believe in the cause or they're pressed into it. It's complicated. The foreigners tend to join for more ideological reasons than the locals do. And I can say with regards to the ones that come from Europe, they have a mix of motivations. They're not always the same. But there is an allure about the Islamic State. The Islamic State, because of its horrific acts of violence, it is also almost the ultimate sign of youthful rebellion of joining the Islamic State. There are few things more counter to the culture of mainstream Islam in the West and to mainstream culture in the West than the Islamic State. I mean, think about the way that neo-Nazis recruit. Nazism is a vile ideology that most people believe has been long discredited. And yet, neo-Nazi groups continue to recruit in the United States, they recruit in Europe, and they trade on their pariah status as a way to get young people, and young people join because, you know, they want to revolt. That's not all that's at work, but it's a big part of it. Many of them are also attracted by the end of days stuff, by the chance to build a state, by a chance to protect fellow Sunni Muslims, so on and so forth. Their recruitment online, there's one thing to note about the Islamic State's recruitment online, because the question often comes up, what do you do to counter it? There is not much that you can do to counter it online if you are confined to just words. This is not going to be won through an argument. Why? Because the Islamic State does not care if it's popular or not. It likes to be viewed as horrible. It likes to be viewed as extreme. It's trying to polarize public opinion. Unlike Al-Qaeda, which was trying to win over most Muslims, the Islamic State is not. You know, I worked a lot on the counter-message effort against Al-Qaeda, and the task was pretty straightforward. If Al-Qaeda ever polled well in a country, we would try to drive down its poll numbers. It was pretty straightforward, and we could be pretty successful at it. But if our current enemy does not care about its poll numbers, if it likes to poll at 2% or 3%, what do you do against an enemy like that? And I would also say that the Islamic State itself has a two-word slogan, and it tells you a lot about how they see themselves and how they recruit. Their two-word slogan is enduring, expanding. That has to do with survival and the acquisition of more territory. They have hinged everything, all their legitimacy and credibility, on their ability to be politically successful in building and establishing and protecting a state. The more you take away that state, the more you erode their appeal. And in this case, unlike the fight against Al-Qaeda, the ideological fight in this case is an actual fight.
Let's look at second and third order effects of a civil war in Syria and this dissolution and failed states in other parts of North Africa and the Middle East. We have a refugee crisis. Why is that really falling squarely on Europe and then also impacting the United States and other Western countries? Why are none of the other Arab countries, especially Sunni Arabs, not willing to bring refugees in or take part of the share in that crisis?
Right, because they are free riding on others. If others are willing to do it, they're not going to want to do it, because taking in refugees, as we see, brings all kind of political and social turmoil. And they, like other politicians, are worried about it. They're worried about how their population is going to react, and if others are kind enough to do it, well, let them do it. It's also the case that they are not investing enough in camps in the countries surrounding Syria and Iraq, the camps in Turkey, the camps in Jordan, which are taking in hundreds of thousands of people, have not been adequately funded. We in the West haven't done enough, and our wealthy Gulf partners have not done enough. And that's really what is causing this refugee crisis, is they have nowhere else to go. I mean, Assad is pushing them out by dropping barrel bombs, but the fact is the camps they could go to in the region are not being well-resourced enough, and therefore it's flowing out as a consequence.
One of the things in your book that you look at, that the leadership of ISIS tries to portray themselves as very pious, very disciplined, very holy, and committed to their religion. You tend to pull out some of the other fraudulent pieces and some of the corruption that's involved. Can you talk a little bit about that in terms of what are some of the public messaging or strategic communication opportunities that we have to undermine this organization?
Sure. So in current messaging against the Islamic State, we're refighting the last war. We're doing the same kind of thing we did against Al-Qaeda. One of the messages that really worked against Al-Qaeda was to show how brutal it was to Sunnis. They were trying to see themselves as protectors of the Sunnis and win them over, and then we would get information out that showed that they are not being protectors of the Sunnis. Pretty straightforward. We're doing the same thing with the Islamic State, but the Islamic State is not trying to win over a broad swath of the population. So what we will do is, or what we have been doing, is putting brutal images from the Islamic State of it executing people, beheading people, and then the Islamic State would say, yes, this is exactly the images we want getting out there, because we're trying to intimidate people. The kind of information you're talking about is much more useful. Like any large organization, there is corruption. And in order to finance their war, they have had to make a lot of shady deals. The more that kind of information comes to light, the more it tarnishes their credibility and their reputation for being incorruptible.
So we have time for maybe one or two additional questions. Let me just roll into this one. What is, in your opinion, what's the worst case scenario that can happen from this? And what's the best case, given the current status we have? After the Arab Spring, there was a lot of energy and enthusiasm about democracy taking hold in some of these countries. Since then, maybe we've learned that a lot of countries aren't ready for democratic institutions and reforms, that, you know, that they still have some growing to do under another form of government, which maybe isn't the most acceptable to us as Americans who have grown up in a democracy. But what's the worst case and what's the best case scenario specifically for Syria and Iraq right now, given this problem?
Right. So the worst case scenario, I think, is that there's no end to the Syrian civil war, which in a big way is the engine that is driving all of these conflicts. If it continues to fester, all of this that we've been talking about tonight will continue to get worse. The worst case scenario also means that the Islamic State goes nowhere. It continues to benefit from the inattention of the people in the neighborhood, and that it continues to expand outward, builds a strong base in Libya, which it's doing with great energy, or attempting to with great energy at the moment, advances in Yemen, advances in Afghanistan. Anywhere that they go, they will continue to disrupt the politics of these countries in civil war or political transition. What I'm worried most about, actually, is Tunisia. Tunisia is the one bright spot in the Arab Spring. It's the one country that has had a successful transition of power, but its economy is limping along. The two different main parties, the more secular one, the more religious one, are very suspicious of one another. And terror attacks, as we can see in our own politics, terror attacks have the ability to polarize politics and to make it hard for politicians at the top from different parties to make important deals. And my worry is that the Islamic State will continue to carry out attacks in Tunisia. It has thousands of fighters from Tunisia. Many of them have gone to Syria, but many of them are also right next door in Libya. They are the ones who have been carrying out attacks inside the country, and my worry is that they will be successful in derailing the one bright spot of the Arab Spring, which would be a major catastrophe, I think.
Okay, and our final question, given all the complexities, Russia is now a major player in this conflict. Iran has been a major player in this conflict. You're now seeing France, by the nature of being attacked, becoming a larger player in this conflict. How likely is it that an effective international coalition can be built in relatively short order and put on the same path to fight a common enemy and you know, not just contain, but destroy that?
Unlikely, because everyone is pulling in a different direction, and you can't do it by air power alone. And it's doubtful that Russia is going to contribute the troops in Syria in order to do this. Most of its bombings are focused on the rebels that are going after Assad. It's not focused on the Islamic State. We are, because of our recent history, deeply reluctant to commit those troops. And looking around the neighborhood, it's not obvious what local government is going to commit the troops either. And that's the real challenge. We can continue to strangle the Islamic State and eat at it piecemeal, which I think is the right thing to do, to keep it in a box. But the unsolved question is, who puts that force in on the ground that displaces the Islamic State and smothers it as an insurgency? It will not be an easy thing to do, and there is no obvious partner for that effort right now.
So, you know, a caliphate now, brutality, yeah, with an apocalyptic vision is what we're looking at, and an international strategy that really can't get to the heart of the matter, that is working on the fringes and letting this thing continue to metastasize, and whether it decreases or increases remains to be seen. Thank you for those remarks, Will. We've received a great briefing from you tonight, and I think we all feel smarter. This concludes our program for this evening. On behalf of the Marines Memorial Club and the World Affairs Council, we thank you all for attending, and Will is gonna stay here for a while. We have Books, Inc. has provided some books, and he's gonna sign those for a short while after the presentation. Quick ad for our next event here at the Marines Memorial Club. On the 20th of January, we have Emma Skye, who, as a political advisor in Iraq, collected all of her observations and experiences in a book called The Unraveling. And after that, I promise we're gonna change the topic and go on to a different part of the world. Or something, but we hope that some of you can attend that as well. Thank you for coming tonight, and wish you a good night.
Thank you. All right, thank you. Yeah.